The theme for this is protecting a multi-stakeholder web. One of the most interesting developments, if you're a political scientist, has been the emergence of a new model of decision-making, of governance of institutions. In some senses, of course, it's not new in any way, shape, or form, but alongside business, government, treaty organizations, NGOs, and so forth, we now have the model of multi-stakeholder governance. So we've got a bunch of different talks that approach this problem in different ways. We've got five talks lined up. This is a lightning talk format, so I'm not going to do any intros. You can look up the people online. We're not going to do any Q&A. What we very much encourage you to come and meet the speakers afterwards, get to know them personally, talk to them about what they're talking, what they're working on. And so with no further ado, I'll just intro this first talk by saying that one of the most awesome events in the kind of fight for internet freedom in the last couple of years was the emergence of a very much bottoms-up, activist-driven organization, collective maybe, network is maybe the right word to say, in India around net neutrality and network regulation. It was called SaveTheInternet.in. That organization has now evolved and moved forward. I'm very pleased to say that our first two speakers are going to tell us what's going on with them. And you can get up on stage if you want to, or do it from down here as you wish.
So I'll speak from down here, and thank you so much for that introduction. To give a little background about who we are the Internet Freedom Foundation, and we are coming from the Save the Internet campaign, which was run in India a year back. The Save the Internet campaign in India concerned generating awareness and petitioning government for bringing forward a regulation on network neutrality, which eventually resulted in more than a million people petitioning government on a regulatory process. Now, this was unprecedented in India, and India matters, and this is what is why it is important to realize what an organization hopes to do and how it is hoping to achieve certain objectives which tie in with its charter. India has a large English-speaking population. It's the world's largest democracy, but it also has the second highest number of internet users. These internet users by themselves, are the way they're going to experience the internet is also going to similarly design as well as impact the internet itself in terms of the services which are used onto it. Here it becomes very important for certain advocacy outcomes which are premised on free expression, privacy, innovation, and network neutrality to be present in India, because what happens in India will also start impacting the world as much as what is happening in the world has started impacting India. Now, what do we hope to do and how do we plan to carry forward Save the Internet's work? We are a volunteer-driven organization in the sense that we do public advocacy, we break down issues which concern free expression, for instance, network shutdowns, work with content producers such as stand-up comics to produce videos of 5 to 10 minutes which can break down the issue, reach across to a popular audience. The basis of our advocacy draws in from the excellent research which is done by existing research institutions in India, and many of them are here. They are showcasing their research. We utilize it, we break it down, we communicate it, and then we bring forward a large segment of the population, and by using online tools again, we petition government for certain outcomes. At the same point of time, we have turned into a full rights-based advocacy organization. We have also impeded as a party in a case in the High Court of Delhi, and this has been our first legal intervention in the right to be forgotten. We are increasingly looking to be a litigant as well to advance outcomes which may cause friction with certain segments of government. Given that all such outcomes may not be possible through partnerships and through conversation itself, I request everyone who's here to please have a look at our website, which segments focus areas between network neutrality, censorship and free expression, online privacy and encryption, and innovation. We have launched formally as an organization on August 15, 2016. We are fairly young. We are in a transitory structure. And August 15th also is symbolic for Indians, being our Independence Day. We hope to carry forward this symbolism with a sense of idealism and advocacy outcomes. And underlying all our work will be impact. I'll now hand it over to Kiran, who's a technologist, and this is also something which is very core to the organization, bridging the gap between people who work in policy, who have a predisposition towards legal methodologies, and also people who are technologists and understand technology itself, and hope making that conversation happen. And Kiran can explain a little much more about the challenges we face in the model of execution as we are seeing ourselves roll out.
Sure. So among the things that we intend to stand for is, if we are going to stand for internet and freedom in India, it would help if we also reflected the diversity of India within our own organization. And that's one of the things that we need to get to. And so in the spirit of being transparent about how we work, I'm going to list out all the problems that we have, all the challenges that we have, even if they don't look great. You know, it's important that if you want to solve a problem, you need to first acknowledge that the problem exists, and including why does the problem exist in the first place. So I want to make a list of those. You know, among the things that's important for us is we are a volunteer-run organization. We have no funding whatsoever. We do obviously take donations. If you fill out the form there, you'll get asked to give us some money. We get some donations, but we do not spend it on ourselves. Both of us here are present here at RightsCon on our own funding. We're spending our own money to be here. It's not coming out of the organization. And this is something that we think is extremely critical, that we need to be a volunteer-run organization as something that establishes a baseline for how we intend to proceed. Now, problem number one that comes out of being a volunteer-run organization is you need to be able to volunteer to participate in a volunteer-run organization. And that itself is a statement of privilege. Not everyone can afford to be a volunteer. Okay? First problem that we need to solve, that while we have been successful as a campaigning structure, coming out as a grassroots movement built entirely on the support of volunteers, as an explanation of exactly what I mean by built on volunteers, one of the campaigns that we ran ended up being a campaign against Facebook. Facebook spent an estimated $300 million in advertising in India. Our campaign probably spent no more than $300. Okay? We won the entire campaign. Okay. Now, what's important is that $300 is misleading because it does not account for the cost of our time. We spent a lot of time. In fact, we gave up 1 year of all our spare time to be able to run a campaign of that sort. And that, to me, is a problem. It's a statement of privilege. I can afford to do that. Not everyone can. So that's one of the problems that we intend to solve going forward. We also, being a campaigning organization, campaigns need to be nimble. They need to move really fast when the occasion calls for it. Something happens today, you need to be able to respond tomorrow. One of the things that is required to do that kind of response cycle is having a high degree of trust between campaign coordinators. And this, unfortunately, also means that you're reinforcing existing trust chains. Two people who trust each other before they were in the campaign will now trust each other inside the campaign. It once again, you know, reinforces trust and privilege that was there before we came in. So these are two things that we think is a problem. I think it should have been obvious also that we are two men out here. There's a fairly obvious diversity problem between just the two of us out here. This is, once again, something that comes out of the way we've been formed, out of just people who, you know, came on board to respond to something, decided to formalize what we do. So what we've done so far with the Internet Freedom Foundation is something that we consider as being just a transitory structure. The methods that helped us be successful running campaigns are not going to help us build a long-term organization. And so what we are trying to do is to say, okay, here's a group that came together under whatever conditions existed while we were campaigning, and now it's our job to build an enduring structure, including acknowledging the privilege that we come with when we got so far. One of the other things that's also a problem for us is because the work that we do occasionally involves friction with government, we need to be very careful about when we come under government regulation. And one of the things that happens in India is we have what's called the Foreign Currency Regulation Act that essentially limits how we can spend money that was brought in from outside the country. Which means that we're here in front of you to say, we can't take your money. So we're not here to say, please support us with money. We're here to say, please support us by acknowledging that we exist, by connecting us to your networks, by volunteering for us, by helping us participate in the work that you already do. In one area that's particularly critical, because when you work with technology, technology is not localized, it's global. People who use Facebook in India use the same Facebook that people who use Facebook in the US use it. People who use Tor use the same software in the US or in India or anywhere else in the world. Software is not built for local purposes, which means that the tools that we need to work on, the tools that we build and the tools that we depend on are the same tools that everybody else around the world does. There is no reason for us to be reinventing the wheel to say, let's build tools for India that are separate from the tools for the Middle East or tools from Africa or so on. We would rather do global collaborations on technology, and that's one of the things that I'm here for, and that I'm hoping to build those partnerships, look for others who are doing technology work that we can adopt, share the technology work that we have built, make sure others use it and benefit from it. And so we're here to chat about any of those things.
Just to sum it up and end it, we are right now, again, I'm stating a very young organization. We are still discovering our culture, but we do know that an organization is required in India. A one-off movement by itself, even if you take the case of net neutrality, is not solved by one petition campaign. The petition campaign only resulted in a regulation on pricing discrimination, and at present, there's a wider network neutrality consultation on the technical aspects of it. We may build another technical tool to petition government, the regulator, which is looking at this consultation. As we stand before you today, and again, going back to when we were launched on August 15, 2016. August 15 is also called our Independence Day, not only because we got independence, but because our Constituent Assembly, which drafted the Constitution, was sworn in that day. There's adoption in that committee itself towards the end in the address. So what we are showing is promise here today, and it's a promise that we are making, and we hope we can fulfill it in time. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was awesome. If you're involved with the Internet Freedom Foundation, raise your hand. I know you're not the only two here. Also, Raman over there. So anybody that wants to track them down afterwards, please do. Those are the three to go for. Thank you. So our next talk, I'm going to get off the floor just because. Our next lightning talk is from Jan Gerlach from the Wikimedia Foundation. His talk is about hyperlinks, protecting the connected nature of the web. Do you want to come up? Well, it does. I know. Now that we've got a precedent set, fine. Do you need this mic?
I probably do. All right. Oh, I need this as well. Oh, not enough hands. Too many mics. Right. Hello, everybody. My name is Jan Gerlach. I am a public policy manager for the Wikimedia Foundation, and I'm here to talk to you about the value of protecting the hyperlink and why this is important. And I'm also here to talk about silos, and I'm sorry if you signed up for a digital rights talk here, and this is about agriculture. Not really. We're talking about the hyperlink because the hyperlink is basically the glue that holds the web together. You use the hyperlink to go from one website to another. It allows you to navigate the web. You can play games. How often do you click somewhere to go to X? But of course, it's also important for collaboration. This is what a hyperlink looks like. You have a URL in it. It's embedded in HTML. This is actually the URL for the Wikipedia article about the hyperlink. This is what a hyperlink can also look like. And it sometimes is useful to remind ourselves how we use hyperlinks. So we set hyperlinks to point out what's going on in the world, to point people to news, to actually like criticize something, to express ourselves. Maybe just send it to somebody, be like, hey, look at this, this is really interesting. And essentially, the hyperlink is a form of freedom of expression. This means it's also used for collaboration. And one prime example, I would suggest, of collaboration online is Wikipedia. It's built entirely by volunteers who work together to collect content and to basically, through peer review, also see what is valid encyclopedic content. So the hyperlink really matters on Wikipedia. You're looking at the references for the article about the hyperlink, actually, which has a lot of hyperlinks itself, pointing to outside sources. And this is the list of external links for the article about climate change. And I guess we all agree that in these times, trustworthiness is really important. And actually, on Wikipedia, verifiability is something that is directly supported by hyperlinks. You will find a lot of information outside of Wikipedia. You can go there, confirm this is true, and actually bring back that content and add to Wikipedia. However, the hyperlink has a problem. It's not its own fault, but we need to do something about it. I want to briefly touch upon various silos of policy and law that threaten the hyperlink. I have five examples that I just want to briefly, high level, touch upon. First one is copyright. Many of you will know the GS Media case from last year, where a website in the Netherlands repeatedly linked to other websites that offered photos that infringe copyright. Those links went dead later. They were, to my knowledge, put up new links and then were held liable for that. The European Court of Justice found that this act actually can be defined as communicating to the public under the Information Society Directive. And what's interesting is the definition apparently means that you knew or should have known that the content is infringing, and on top of that, if you do it for profit, it's definitely communication to the public. So that is definitely a problem for the hyperlink, because you can then not link to things that you know are copyright infringing. Another silo is liability for defamation. Also, last year in Hungary, a website linked to a YouTube video with allegedly defaming statements in a report about unruly behavior of football fans. The party criticized in that video then sued the website, and the website was held was found liable for defamation. The case is now pending before the European Court. The case is now pending before the European Court of Human Rights. But of course, what does that mean? Can you criticize somebody? Can you not? Can you link to something that you may not even agree with? And in fact, the party that sued was not even mentioned on the website. Next example is enforcement of rights and court decisions. Also last year, and also still pending before the Canadian Supreme Court, is a case called Equistec versus Google, in which Equistec, a network equipment manufacturer, sued or sought an order against Google to remove links to websites that sold infringing products after it had won against a competitor. And the Supreme Court of British Columbia then ordered Google to take down links to those websites globally. So the problem here is actually extraterritorial jurisdiction and the fact that Google, a third party, was drawn into this. So this is highly problematic, of course, to the hyperlink, to people looking for information online. Another very current example is our new rights for press publishers. In the EU right now, there's a proposal on the table for a new directive of copyright in the digital single market. Article 11 actually gives press publishers the exclusive right over their works online, which of course for the hyperlink is very problematic, because the hyperlink gets more valuable as you add more context around it, which includes snippets and other information. We will probably talk more about this in coming copyright sessions tomorrow and on Friday. Well, actually, certainly. And finally, a policy silo that I would suggest to look at is a content regulation. Governments, policymakers trying to clap down on hate speech, on fake news, and other things that they find harmful to society. Of course, that forces platforms, or they want to force platforms to regulate by monitoring all the content that goes up, and that will eventually also include hyperlinks. So, to sum up, I think we're looking at very many threats to the hyperlink in different policy silos, and we tend to think about them like that. Some are clear, some are more blurry, but I would suggest that we look at a general threat to the hyperlink here, not just like focus on copyright, focus on privacy, focus on enforcement, whatever it be. We have to fix the issue that surrounds the hyperlink here, and if the hyperlink is glue, we may need more glue, but certainly we need to break down this silo thinking, and essentially the goal here is especially for the Wikimedia Foundation, to really make it possible for people to access knowledge and to bring this knowledge to people, not lock it up. And the hyperlink is really what helps the web do this and what helps everybody do this. And with that, I hope you keep that in mind and don't think in policy silos.
Great, thank you very much. Thank you, Jan. Okay, on to our third talk. James and Neil, if you'll come up. James Marchant and Neil Blazevich are going to, Blazevich, I'm sorry, we just talked about the correct way to pronounce that, are going to talk to us about information controls in East Africa, challenges for civil society. Over to you.
Thanks. Is there a clicker? Great. Yes, I'm James Marchant. I'm from Small Media. I'm joined by Neil from Defend Defenders, a Ugandan digital security organization. And we're here to talk to you today about a new report we've actually just published the other week called Safeguarding Civil Society, Assessing Internet Freedom and the Digital Resilience of Civil Society in East Africa. And so this project... Okay. This project was developed in partnership between Small Media, Defend Defenders, CIPESA, an internet policy organization based in Uganda, and the Center for Intellectual Property and Information Technology Law at Strathmore University in Nairobi. And so, yeah, this project aimed to achieve three primary objectives. Firstly, we were interested in mapping out the state of internet freedom across the East Africa region with a particular focus on Burundi, Rwanda, Uganda, Tanzania, and South Sudan. We felt that these contexts, the legislative situation in these countries wasn't being fully understood or mapped out by other international organizations working on internet freedom, so we thought it was important to kind of catalog various violations and problematic piece of legislation that are being implemented. And so CIPESA led the policy analysis to answer those questions. We also wanted to explore how the legislative frameworks that were being introduced and that existed impacted upon the work of civil society in these countries. So to go out and actually interview civil society organizations, whether they be women's groups, media freedom organizations, political rights organizations, LGBT organizations, to see how this wide array of different civil society groups perceived changes in internet freedom legislation, and to kind of ascertain the different threats that they perceived from this legislation. And then finally, we also wanted to assess how the infrastructure of the internet in each of these countries facilitated or didn't facilitate information controls. So for that we used UniProbe and ICE Internet Censorship Labs Sentinel technology. So to begin with, we'll just talk briefly through our policy analysis. So as the framework for this research, we wanted to use the African Declaration on Internet Rights and Freedoms, which was a declaration that was drafted in 2014 by a large coalition of African civil society organizations and international internet freedom organizations. And its purpose was to promote human rights and promote openness of internet policy formulation and implementation by governments and other stakeholders. And so we undertook a broad analysis of legislation in each of these countries and then attempted to build a model to analyze the extent of government compliance with the African Declaration. So this is what we put together. So we can see that there's general non-compliance on issues of such as freedom of assembly, privacy, personal data protections, and freedom of expression. So I'll just breeze very quickly through each of the countries. So in Burundi, there's a particularly difficult situation with regard to internet freedom. Constitutional guarantees aren't that bad on paper, but implementation is very poor generally. You have laws like law number 115, which applies the very tough regulatory frameworks that are used for TV journalists and newspaper journalists to bloggers and online journalists. There are very strict defamation laws, which have been previously used to imprison users on the basis of WhatsApp messages, which happened in 2016. And back in 2015 also, the National Telecoms Regulator blocked access to a number of chat applications in order to essentially stifle an opposition movement. In Rwanda, you see similarly a number of internet freedom challenges and a number of online media outlets have been closed down and blocked since 2015. And even opposition activists in exile have seen their websites attacked, potentially by state actors inside Rwanda. South Sudan is clearly facing a number of challenges at the moment in terms of ongoing civil conflict. And the internet, like the internet freedom landscape is still very much emerging. But a number of laws have been introduced that are making it very easy to facilitate arrests without due process. Tanzania, similarly, is very good at expanding access, we found, but has introduced a number of laws that make it very straightforward to arrest activists on fairly spurious charges. You've got the 2015 Cybercrimes Act, which has been used to clamp down on freedom of expression online. Similarly, the Media Services Act of 2016 criminalizes a great deal of online content, and you've seen fairly high-profile individuals such as Maxence Mello, who's the he runs Jammy Forums, which is the most influential online forum in Tanzania. He was arrested late last year on the basis of hosting a website outside of Tanzania. Again, fairly spurious. Uganda, similarly, has a number of items of legislation, such as the 2015 Computer Misuse Act, which forbids offensive communication, and also the 2013 Communications Act, which has been used to facilitate or legitimize internet shutdowns, such as in the 2016 presidential elections. So that was the landscape, and now I'm going to hand over to Neil to talk about how this affects civil society.
Thank you. So what about civil society? How are they reacting to these changes in the legislative environment, and how prepared are they to stand up to reduce space and possibly increased threats to their work? So to get into this question, we created two measures. One is called the Threat Perception Index, which we divided by the perception of whether the threats are coming from state actors or non-state actors. So to get at this, we asked questions like, what's your experience of digital threats? Are you facing malware? Are you facing hacking, phishing, surveillance? What's your perception? The second index is the Digital Resilience Index, which looked at the preparedness and the ability of civil society to actually respond to threats and invest in the resources necessary to understand them and face up to them. So we asked things like, what sort of security software do you use? What kind of IT personnel do you have in your organization? Do you know somebody? Who can you turn to in case there's some kind of a digital threat? So the methodology that we used here was to hire researchers from the four countries of the study. We had 9 researchers. They came together for a week-long methodology training where they were trained on interview skills and also how to use the network measurement tests that James mentioned. So I'm not going to go into all the country-level results, but I pulled out a few of the highlights. So you can also see on the left-hand side how we're splitting up the ratings, both the threat perceptions and the digital resilience. So here's an example from Burundi. Many of the organizations saw phishing as a problem that they've experienced, and we actually were able to document a spearfish, which is not the UN or Nigerian prince scam, but a kind of phishing email which is clearly targeted to you or your situation. So this is an email received from civil society, someone purporting to be sympathetic to their cause, saying that they're a security expert, that they want to assist them to secure their email. And please, you can just secure your email by following this link for your Gmail. I'm gonna send you a link for Yahoo later. But when we follow through on this link, it's actually a fake Gmail login page that was designed to steal credentials. And this was actually successful on a number of highly prominent civil society leaders. So here's a sample of the digital resilience ratings. So on the right-hand side, you can see the kind of questions that we're looking at. And we see, for example, practice of antivirus is really what people think of when they think of digital security, so that's quite high. But then other aspects, such as backup, email encryption, data encryption, and two factors is much, much less observed. Then we also, in terms of training or knowing who to turn to in case you have a problem, in Burundi, for example, much fewer people had received trainings, only 5 out of. Yeah, 4 out of 10. So now Rwanda is, if any of you know Rwanda, you'll also know that it's a difficult country to work in the human rights sector. So we had difficulties, individuals not wanting to be interviewed, not trusting the interviewers, or not feeling comfortable to actually answer the questions being asked. And among the organizations which did respond, there was a clear polarization of responses. So I have a couple quotes up on the screen. So yeah, basically in terms of whether the perpetrators of hacking were state-based or non-state-based, the answers were just totally divergent. So one group would say, no, I don't think hackers can be state actors. Most of the time they're private individuals. As far as we are concerned, we think hackers are private individuals. Versus another group which says, when you're defending human rights, the first person to criticize is the government, and the government sometimes takes human rights defenders as the opponents, but that is not correct. When the government cannot act, it acts through someone else. An individual can be manipulated to serve interests of the state or to serve his or her financial interests and to cause you trouble. And if you look at the ratings of Rwanda, you'll see that it's a very low score of threat from the state, the perception. But when you get into the numbers, some of the organizations just refused to answer that question. So we had a null response. And we have to read into that they don't feel comfortable to attribute any threats to the state. In terms of Tanzania, out of time? All right, thank you. So I won't go through all the country level responses. but the third part of the research was network measurements. So we used the two tools that James mentioned, UNI probe from the Tor project, and IC Lab, which is a collaboration of different universities. And we used the two because we thought that we'd have more comparable findings by using them. And we used the same country-level researchers to carry out the research. So they were given a laptop and trained on how to use the tools on the command line. So So over the course of 3 months, they tested four different ISPs in the four countries. And it's really looking for three things. First is, are particular websites blocked? So if you measure a website inside the country and then measure it again outside the country, is there a discrepancy? Second is, are there middle boxes? Meaning, are your network requests being modified in some way, which is indicative that there's some kind of device on the network? And thirdly, we were looking at throttling and speed issues, but in the end, it was really difficult to draw conclusions based on the speed measurements. So the findings were that in Burundi, Uganda, and Tanzania, there were no website blockages that we could find. And in Rwanda, we found 9 addresses on our test list, which were blocked. And all of those websites were really of a political nature, political and news and human rights nature. In Uganda and Tanzania, we did find evidence of middle boxes. And also just to highlight that there are state-owned ISPs in all of the countries, but none of them are prevalent in the country. None of them are market leaders. So it highlighted the fact that private companies are the lead actors implementing blocks and potentially surveillance in the countries.
Cool. Okay, so just to round off very quickly. So we feel this report demonstrates fairly clearly the need for civil society to really begin mobilizing on a broad basis in defense of internet freedom across the region, not just internet freedom organizations, but it's clear that all of these different types of civil society organizations are negatively affected by the current environment. We've also seen that in each of these countries, government policy is out of alignment with the African Declaration on Internet Rights and Freedoms, and a great deal of advocacy needs to be continued to correct that. And similarly, we've highlighted a lot of need for digital security development of civil society across the region. And so it's important that digital security organizations are empowered to support these communities and these civil society organizations. And also that the private sector should be a real key target for advocacy around internet freedom challenges, because they are the ones actually implementing these policies at the end of the day. So hopefully that was helpful, and thanks.
That was awesome. Thank you very much. That's really interesting research in a region that I think needs a lot more sunlight. Our fourth out of 5 talks, so we're getting down to the wire here, but I think these last two are going to be barn burners. Our fourth talk is Puneet Nagaraj, who is going to be speaking to us about Indian engagement in internet governance institutions.
Hello, I'm Puneet Nagaraj from the Center for Communication Governance at the National Law University, Delhi. I'm here to present a report on, it's called Multi-Stakeholderism in Action. Just a quick note about our organization. We're a research center based out of a law university in India, and we focus on information policy issues. We're also the only academic center that takes a legal and policy perspective on many information technology issues in India. In the past, our work has had impact on a number of contemporary issues like net neutrality, privacy, hate speech, and intermediary liability. And going forward, we hope to focus on more cutting-edge issues like artificial intelligence. The research I'm about to present here is a culmination of our following internet governance institutions like the WSIS process, the IGF, and ICANN for the last few years. Our work was generously supported by the MacArthur Foundation. So in this report, we looked at the last 5 years of Indian engagement between 2011 and 2015. We came to a range of conclusions, and I'm here to present maybe a couple of them so you get a flavor of what's in the report. We primarily did this report because of two realities of the Indian engagement with internet governance. The first is that India is a key swing state in internet governance debates. Now, this means that a lot of people want to know what are Indians seeing at these institutions, or what are Indian stakeholders' positions at these institutions. And the second thing was that there's no documentation or systematic analysis of what Indian stakeholders are saying, what positions they're taking at these institutions. And we reached two conclusions. The two conclusions I'm about to present, I classify them as the not-so-surprising and the very surprising. The not-so-surprising conclusion is that Indians are not saying much at internet governance institutions. And I say this because, actually it's better with an illustration. Thanks. So if we just take ICANN, for instance, and if you look at the mailing lists there, we found that most interventions from Indians were either the dreaded plus ones, and most people who are on mailing lists here will know that plus ones are basically people agreeing with what someone said before, or most other interventions basically disagreed with what someone said before, and they're not substantially contributing to the debates, other than spamming your inboxes. So what we did was we divided these interventions into either active responses or non-active responses. And the stark contrast you'll see here in this breakdown is that if you see the number of Indians engaging on any particular issue and the number of active interventions in green, there's a huge disparity. excuse me. And we found that there are a number of reasons for this. This can be either because of capacity, it's because of a lack of sustained engagement, it's because of the amount of time Indians are able to, Indian stakeholders are able to spend on internet governance issues. Again, there's a lot of nuance in this study, and I'm happy to chat about this later on. And there are copies of the report here if anybody wants, if you want to, please feel free to pick it up. And the second conclusion, that's the most surprising conclusion, is that there's almost no private sector engagement with internet governance institutions. And this, again, I show you a chart from the WSIS process. So in the WSIS process, there was literally no private sector engagement from India. And here we're talking, the way we defined it, we were looking at the 6 month to one year long process, where there were no statements from Indian stakeholders, there were no interventions, there were no submissions, and there was no interest either. And even in an institution like ICANN, where you would think that there's a more obvious private sector interest, we found that there was very limited private sector interest in engaging with ICANN. And in collecting data for our study, we looked at meeting records that go back 5 years. We held interviews. We spoke with stakeholders. We circulated a questionnaire. And one of the things that a former private sector representative told us was that this is simply down to the nature of Indian private sector engagement with policy issues. They told us that most Indian private sector prefers to engage directly with the government, or that they rely on informal channels to influence government policy. And when they encounter spaces where there are other stakeholders, their approach is to capture the space rather than engage with the space. Now, this is interesting in the Indian context, because in the last couple of years, the Indian government has repeatedly come out in support of the multi-stakeholder model of engagement. This means that the private sector kind of has to speak to other stakeholders involved in internet governance processes. And it promises to be an interesting space. And we see even now that the private sector's being asked to come to government meetings, the government is convening multi-stakeholder dialogues on many internet governance issues. In closing, the thing we wanted out of this talk is to receive feedback on whether this is a useful exercise, possibly in other contexts. We're planning on expanding this study to other institutions. We also follow the International Telecommunications Union. We follow the Working Group on Enhanced Cooperation. We also work closely with the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. And we were wondering if this framework that we've developed might possibly be useful to other contexts, or if you have any useful experiences that you might want to share that's relevant to the research we've conducted, we'd be happy to hear from you. And I'm here at least until tomorrow afternoon. I'm happy to chat about it. And again, you can find copies of our report there. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Okay, it's our last lightning talk out of all of the four sessions today. So no pressure, Nick, but we're counting on you to make this the most memorable one of all. So longtime comrade and partner in crime, Nick Grossman, the floor is yours.
All right, I think I'm mic'd.
Oh.
Already. Hey, everybody. I will keep this quick so we can all have a drink. So in some ways, what I'm going to talk about is a continuation of the earlier session about personal data and privacy, and in some ways, it's also very much about what we've been talking about here, which is power and governance and the cultivation of emerging new web standards. And here's my clicker. Let's find the button. Okay, so I'm from Union Square Ventures. We're a VC firm based in New York City. We've been around for about 12 years or so and have invested in a lot of web application platforms, many that you've heard of like Twitter and Etsy and Kickstarter, some that you may use like Twilio or Cloudflare. The common theme throughout our whole time has been platforms with strong network effects. So network effect being the bigger it gets, the better it gets. And I'll come back to that idea. Increasingly, we've been also been investing in two new areas. One is internet access, pure play open internet access. We have three investments that are doing broadband, fiber, and wireless in new ways. And then the other one we're looking into really heavily is the blockchain and cryptocurrencies and decentralized data systems. And bless you, Andrew. And part of what we're getting at is we spent the first 12 years of our life investing in platforms with network effects, and now we're trying to figure out how to undo those network effects because maybe they become a little bit too powerful. We're located all over the world. We've got companies on the West Coast and the East Coast in Canada and Europe. Those companies then have employees who live all over the place, and of course we've got users on every continent. So it's a global... What's that?
We're missing Asia.
We're completely missing Asia. We have no Asian companies. We like to work where we can fly within a half day, like here is about as far as we can get, but you're right. And so what I want to talk about is power in the information era, how one amasses power and how we work around that power. So what we've got in today's tech platform landscape are the big players, GAFA, Google, Apple, Facebook, Amazon. And they're the big power players, and the way that we think about them is not just as applications, but as databases. So you can think of Google as a database of links and apps and searches. You can think of Apple as a database of apps and credit cards. You can think of Facebook as a database of photos and likes, and Amazon as a database of products and credit cards. And these are closed databases, siloed databases, and the power in each of these platforms comes from their control of that database. They have exclusive rights to the data in there. There's sort of monopoly control over their data. And it's extraordinarily powerful. So in the first, I believe is the first month or two of first quarter of 2016, 85% of online advertising dollars went to Google and Facebook, and 100% of the growth. So these platforms, as they reach scale, have enormous network effects and have a shit ton of power, to use a technical term. And what they're really all in have is people, stuff, and clicks in a database. And so this is the power model that we're working around. And sort of as that relates to individuals and users, you've got every app, whether they're the big ones or they're a new guy, trying to build some version of a data network effect, trying to collect data, trying to build profiles, and they're all getting sort of a hand on the elephant. But the game is to build as much data to get a powerful data network effect of some in some form. And what we're working really hard on and what we're really very interested in is ways to re-aggregate data around the user and build a data network effect that the user controls that is in the user's orbit and sort of flip the model from the big guys hold all the data to the user has control of the data in some form. And for us, there were a couple presentations earlier about this same idea. Privacy is one reason why you'd be interested in this. There are others. The reason that we are particularly interested in it is competition. We want new companies, new providers to be able to come up and compete, to keep everybody honest, so that there is opportunity. When there are just, four or five big dominant platforms, that's not the kind of open market that we came to love on the web. And so what I will talk about really briefly are three steps that we think we can take to get to a world of personal data sovereignty, where the user has control of their data. Relatively simple. The first is real data portability. So data portability is part of the GDPR coming up here in Europe, the right for a user to move their data from one platform to another. The nuances are still being worked out. But historically, the mindset has been the data is in the apps, and the apps own the data. So that's a click in Google, or it's a like in Facebook, or it's you know, a shopping cart in Amazon. It's not just the actual content, the photos and other things we're uploading, but it's our behavior and our activity. And I think where we need to move is an idea where the user has a right to that data, an interest in that data, because they really co-create it. There wouldn't be any data if the user hadn't created it. And so to shift the mindset and say that there's data there that we've generated together and that we both have an interest in, so that the platform can build a business around that data and the individual can build power around that data. And again, not just about core content, but behavioral data, clicks and likes and the breadcrumb trail that you make as you move about the web. The second idea, to take it a little bit further, is what we refer to as the right to be represented by a bot. So especially in the mobile app ecosystem, what you have is a bunch of apps collecting a bunch of data. You interact directly with all those apps. They keep all that data protected. You can't really kind of, you know, have your own copy of it. But imagine a world where every app were required to create a read-write API such that any user could use that app through that API and maybe keep a copy of that data for themselves off to the side, so they have their own little treasure trove of a complete, perfect picture of their own data, which they could use to, give to researchers or to, build health profiles of themselves off of, to sell to advertisers, who knows what. But the idea being that, you know, the user can create it around themselves and create their own data network effect. And then if in a world like that, rather than have many apps trying to get one hand on the elephant, any app who you like as the user and you trust, you can authorize to get your full picture. And so what we like about this idea is that it is a vastly market expanding opportunity where any small company can come onto the market and build a reputation and be able to bootstrap quickly on top of data from users who trust them, which is really very difficult to do today. And then the last idea, just to get a little too crazy and think outside the box and maybe take it a step or two too far, is about public blockchains. And if you're thinking about public policy solutions, the technical public policy solutions and ideas, we think blockchains are an important part of it. And for those of you who aren't familiar with blockchains and cryptocurrencies, if you think of, you know, today's internet application model, you have a company like a Facebook or an Apple that has a centralized database that they control. They own it. They are the arbiters of truth. You know, it is, the data is the way it is because they say it is. Blockchains and cryptocurrencies, you may be familiar with things like Bitcoin and maybe Ethereum, don't just represent a way of transacting money around on the internet in a new way. They're actually a way of distributing data and verifying that data in public without any single company controlling it. So the reason we care about blockchains is not because of the financial mechanism underneath it, although that is important. It is because it's a fundamentally different data architecture where the data lives out on the web. It is controlled by the users who have their keys to, you know, manage their data, and no single company has full control over that data. So one way to think about the potential of blockchains is opening up data the way that HTTP and TCP/IP opened up communications. And so blockchain, the reason I mention it here is that blockchains and cryptocurrencies are one of these areas of tech policy that are controversial and new and bleeding edge, and lots can go wrong, but lots can also go right. And the reason we care about them is that they have the potential to augment this new architecture of data that is much more oriented around the user and controlled by the user. So in conclusion, control of data is power. And we, as investors and as advocates for the internet, are looking for lightweight, tech-oriented ways to give more of that power back to users. Thank you.
Thank you, Nick. That was awesome. Well, thank you, everybody, for showing up. Thank you to all the speakers. And really, the purpose of these talks is for you to know why you should go talk to them. So please go do, meet our speakers. And I guess it's on to drinks and parties. So the news could be worse. Thank you.